Today we will show how to evaluate internal forces in trusses using the method of joints. First, let us define what is a truss. If a structure is called a truss, then we know that every joint in the structure is a hinge, even if the hinges are not explicitly drawn. Also, a truss should not have any loads in the spans between the joints. Concentrated loads are allowed only at the locations of the joints. When the above conditions are fulfilled, the structure will qualify as a truss, and every member in the truss will be a link member and will only contain an internal axial force in the direction of the member. So, if we cut the truss into two parts, only one internal axial force will appear at each cut member as shown. Let us now explain what is the method of joints. If we separated one of the joints of the truss by cutting through all the connected members, an internal axial force will appear at each cut member on both sides of the cut. Because the truss is in equilibrium, any part cut from that truss should also be in equilibrium. Therefore, we can apply the equilibrium equations on the separated joint. First, we apply sigma x equals 0. The equation will contain the horizontal force F1 pointing right, so it is positive, the horizontal component of the inclined force F2 pointing right, positive, the horizontal component of the inclined force F3 pointing left, negative, and the force F4 pointing left, negative. Next, we apply sigma y equals 0. The equation will contain the vertical components of F2 and F3, both positive, as they are pointing upwards, and the external force F pointing down, so it is negative. No moment equation could be applied since all the forces pass through one point, which is the joint. So at each node, we can only apply two equilibrium equations. If we separated all the joints and applied the equilibrium equations on all the 7 joints simultaneously, we will obtain 14 equations in 14 unknowns, which we can solve to find all the internal forces in the truss. This is an easy and systematic solution, but it is not suitable for hand calculations, and we'll need a computer to solve the equations. For hand calculations, we first have to evaluate the reactions. Next, we have to work through the joints in a special sequence to simplify the solution. We will search for a joint that has only two unknown internal forces that can be solved by the two equilibrium equations of the joint. For the shown example, if we examined joint E, we would find that it has 3 unknowns, so it will not be suitable to start with. We can start with joint A, which has 2 unknown forces, AE and AC. By applying the two equilibrium equations at joint A, we can evaluate both AE and AC. After AE has been evaluated, joint E now will only have 2 unknowns, EC and EF, which can be evaluated by applying the two equilibrium equations at joint E. Then we search for the next joint that has 2 unknowns. Joint F will not be suitable since it has 3 unknowns at this stage, but joint C can be used since it has only 2 unknowns. We continue in this manner until all the internal forces are evaluated. Before working on examples, we need to establish the sign convention of the internal forces. The internal force in the truss member will be either compression or tension. When we cut the joint out, two sets of internal forces equal in magnitude and opposite in direction will appear. One set is acting on the truss, and this represents the effect of the joint on the members. The other set is acting at the joint and represents the effect of the members on the joint. For the shown example, the joint is trying to pull the members downwards, and the members are trying to pull the joints upwards. Because both sides are trying to pull, then the members are in tension. During problem solution, we usually draw the direction of the forces acting on the joints. So, if the force is emerging from the joint, then it is tension as shown. For a compression member, both the member and the joint are pushing each other. And the force is represented directed towards the joints, as shown. Now let us look at an example. We need to evaluate all the internal member forces using the method of joints. As the first step, we evaluate the reactions. Next, because we need to work with X and Y components of inclined forces, we need to find their angle of inclination. In this problem, all inclined members have the same angle of inclination, which is evaluated to be 45 degrees. As explained earlier, we need to start with a joint which has two unknowns. We start by applying the equilibrium equations at joint A, which has two unknown forces, AC and AE. We assume all the forces to be tension at the beginning, so they are emerging out of the joint. If the equations produce negative value for the force, then the force is compression, and we will reverse its direction. For joint A, AC is found to be zero, and AE is found to be negative 10 kN, so it is compression, and we reverse its direction. Next, we apply the equilibrium on joint E, which now has two unknowns, EC and EF. If we apply sigma x equals 0 first, as usual, both EF and EC will appear in the equation, and this will complicate the solution. Therefore, we will apply sigma y equals 0 first to evaluate the force in EC. Then we can evaluate the force in EF using sigma x equals 0. Next, we apply the equilibrium equations at joint C to evaluate the forces in CD and CF. Then we go to point F to evaluate the forces in FG and FD. After these are evaluated, we then go to point D to evaluate the forces in DB and DG. Finally, we reach joint G, which will have only one unknown, GB. We will apply sigma x equals 0 to evaluate the force in GB. Then we will use the equilibrium equation sigma y equals 0 to validate the results. More validation can be done by applying the equilibrium equations sigma x and sigma y at joint B. Let us look at another example. We need to solve the following K-truss using the method of joints. First, we evaluate the reactions, then we find the angle of inclination of the inclined members. All inclined members have the same angle of inclination, theta. By inspecting the geometry, we evaluate cosine theta as 0.8 and sine theta as 0.6. We will start our analysis by choosing a joint that has two unknown forces. We can choose joint A, which has two unknown forces in AC and AE. As always, we start by assuming that all the forces are tension, and therefore they are directed out of the joint. The force will be reversed if the equation evaluates it as negative. By applying sigma x equals 0, we find the force in AC to be positive 4 kN, so it is tension as assumed. By applying sigma y equals 0, we find the force in AE to be negative 7 kN, so it is compression and its direction should be reversed. If we choose joint E as the next joint, we will find that it has three unknowns, so it is not suitable at the moment. Therefore, we will skip it for now and go to joint H. Joint H has two unknown forces in HE and HI, and can be solved by applying the two equilibrium equations as shown. After HE has been evaluated, joint E now has only two unknowns, EC and EI, and therefore can be solved. However, we notice that both EC and EI will have components in the X and Y directions. So we will have to solve the two equations simultaneously to find the two unknown forces in EC and EI. First, we apply sigma X equals 0 to obtain a relation between EC and EI. By substituting this relation into the other equilibrium equation, we can evaluate both forces. Now that EC has been evaluated, we can continue by solving joint C, which now has two unknowns CF and CD. If we try to work next on joint F, we will find that it has three unknowns, so we will skip it and go to joint I, which has two unknown forces in IJ and IF and can be evaluated. After evaluating the force in IF, now we can return to joint F, which now will have two unknowns, FD and FJ, and can be solved. The next nearest joints are joint J and joint D. By inspecting the joints, we find that each joint has three unknown forces, so we will have to skip them for now and choose another joint. We can work on joint B, which has two unknowns BD and BG. By applying the equilibrium equations, we find that the force in BD is zero and the force in BG is negative 11 kN, so it is compression. After the force in BD is evaluated, we can now apply the equilibrium equations on joint D because now it only has two unknowns DJ and DG. After solving DJ and DG, we are left with three unknown forces, and we still have three joints that we did not use, joints G, J, and K. Each of the three joints can be used next, since each joint has only two unknowns. We will choose joint K. By applying the equilibrium equations on joint K, we solve for the forces in KJ and KG. Next, we go to joint J, which will now have only one unknown, JG. We can evaluate the unknown force in JG by applying the equilibrium equation sigma X equals 0. Then we can use the other equilibrium equation sigma Y equals 0 to validate the solution. We can also apply the equilibrium equations on joint G for more validation.